إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما ثم أما بعد فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار. This introduction we called it خطبة الحاجة. خطبة الحاجة. Our Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم used to start every Jumu'ah by this خطبة, by this introduction. And sometimes not only the Jumu'ah, because we know from the Sunnah of our Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم, he used to make khutbah even if it's not Jumu'ah, if there is like major matter. I'll give you an example. As in Sunan Abi Dawood and Sunan al-Tirmidhi and Sunan ibn Majah, قَالَ جَاءَ قَوْمٌ مِّن بَنِي مُضَرْ مُشْتَابِي الْعَبَاءَةَ أَوْ النِّمَارِ. A tribe, an Arab tribe, we called them Mudar. And they came to Al-Madina and they were so bored. And when our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam saw them, his heart became soft. Like he wanted to give them something. So he called the Muslim for prayer. And he made khutbah. And he started by this. And then he said, لِيَتَصَدَّقَنَّ أَحَدُكُمْ مِنْ دِينَارِهِ لِيَتَصَدَّقَنَّ أَحَدُكُمْ مِنْ دَرْهَمِهِ لِيَتَصَدَّقَنَّ أَحَدُكُمْ مِنْ خَمِيصِهِ. Let one of you, O Muslim, give charity from his dinar. Dinar, it's a golden coin, and it's 4.25 gram. And then he said, لِيَتَصَدَّقَنَّ أَحَدُكُمْ مِنْ دِرْهَمِهِ. دِرْهَمِهِ, it's a silver coin. And inshallah, we will speak about why it's important to know this dirham and dinar, because all the zakat nisab, the minimum amount of zakat, it's related to this, to dirham and dinar. And then he said, let one of you give charity from his clothes. And no one brought anything until Iman, until they saw Iman, went fast to his house out of the masjid, and he brought a bag of money. And he put this bag on a leather carpet. And when the Muslim when the companions saw him, everyone, you know, went to his house and brought what Allah Azza wa Jal gave him, like share everything. Clothes, half of his clothes. Food, half of the food. Money, half of the money. Until a big hips became in front of our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam smiled. And he told the first man, من سن في الإسلام سنة حسنة فله أجرها وأجر من عمل بها ومن سن في الإسلام سنة سيئة فله وزرها ووزر من عمل بها. Who established a sunnah or revived a sunnah in Islam to the man, the first man who went out from the masjid and brought a bag of money. He will get the reward of this money and the reward of the Muslims who follow him or her. And وَمَنْ سَنَّ فِي الْإِسْلَامِ سُنَّةً حَسَنَةً. Anyone established a bad sunnah, a bad sin, a bad matter, a bad action in Islam, he will get the sin of this action, and everyone who follows him. Subhanallah. So what I wanted to tell you, this introduction, we call it khutbatul haja. Khutbatul haja. And our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to say this khutbah in every big matter, or in the Jumu'ah sermon, in the khutbatul Jumu'ah, or even if he wants to give knowledge or a notice to his companion. So the last session I gave the mistake in Salat, and I didn't complete it. And some brothers asked me about many affairs by WhatsApp, like when I spoke about the sutra, the prayer in front of the Muslims, and I said it's a mistake not to have this sutra. Why? Because our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, in authentic narration, he said, as in Sahih al-Bukhari and Muslim, لا يصلين أحدكم إلا إلى سترة. Don't pray except to this sutra. The sutra is something in front of you, should be like كمؤخرة الرحل. مؤخرة الرحل, it's like one third of arm, around like 45 centimeters. Something you put it in front of you to prevent anyone from crossing the prostration area, the sujood area. And a lot of Muslims, you know, they don't do it. They don't like, you know, they don't know, some of them, they don't know it's, we have this rule in Islam. And some of them, you know, they make it easy, it doesn't matter. So what I want to tell you, the narrations about the sutra. عن ابن عمر رضي الله عنهما قال قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم لا تصلي إلا إلى سترة ولا تدع أحدا يمر بين يديك فإن أبى فلتقاتله فإن معه قرين. أخرجه الإمام مسلم. الإمام مسلم reported that ابن عمر رضي الله عنهما said that he heard our Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم said don't pray except to this sutra, to this prayer. And ولا تدع أحدا يمر بين يديك. Don't let anyone to go through the prostration area, the sujood area, between you and your sutra. If he or she doesn't, you know, like, they insist to cross your sujood area, fight them. Because they have a shaytan, qareen. They have shaytan with them. وعن أبي سعيد الخدري رضي الله عنه قال قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم إذا صلى أحدكم فليصلي إلى سترة وليدن منها ولا يدع أحدا يمر بينه وبينها فإن جاء أحد يمر فليقاتله فإنه شيطان. This is the same of that hadith. Our Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم told us don't pray except to this prayer, and don't let anyone to across the sujood area. If they insist, fight them. How do we fight them? We push them like this. Because sometimes we will not take any questions, because you know we need to stuck with the topic. Inshallah, I will ask you at the end. So be prepared. And what's the distance between you and your sutra? The scholar said it's three arms, like 2.5 meters. 2.5 meters between you and your sutra, or less. And if you find a Muslim without sutra and he's praying, it's better to hold him. Don't cross. Our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in authentic hadith, he said, لو يعلم المار بين يدي المصلي ما عليه لكان خيرا له أن يقف 40. قال الصحابي لا أدري أقال 40 سنة أم 40 شهرا أم 40 يوما. Our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in authentic hadith, he said, the one who wants to walk or to cross the sujood area of a Muslim, if he knows that holding, not carrying on in this action, what benefit he will get, it's better for him to stay, to wait for 40. The companion said, I don't know, he said 40 years, 40 months, 40 days. So you will get reward by waiting for your brother to finish his salat. And this is Umar radiallahu anhu. وعن قرة ابن إياس قال رآني عمر وأنا أصلي بين أسطوانتين فأخذ بقفائي فأدناني إلى سترة فقال صلي إليهما. أخرجه البخاري. This is in Al-Bukhari as well. Al-Bukhari here is reporting what Umar radiallahu anhu, his opinion about the sutra. Umar radiallahu anhu used to do something if he saw, if he see someone praying without a sutra. So he used to take the Muslim and guide him to have a sutra. Like Qurrat ibn Iyas, one of the followers. He told him, Umar, don't pray between these two pillars. Pray to a wall or to your brother's back as a sutra. Here we have an affair. This is what they asked me. If the Muslim behind the imam, do they need to maintain their sutra? They are praying behind the imam. No. The sutra, it's only your sutra, it's the imam's sutra. That means if the imam has a sutra, it doesn't for you to have a sutra. So I will give you an example. Imagine if you are praying congregational salat. And some brother, he remembers that he wants to make wudu. And he's praying there. What should he do? He can cross the rows while they are praying. Is that happened in the time of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam? Yes. This has happened in Arafah. Abdullah ibn Umar was a child, like around 10 to 12 years old. And when his father accepted Islam, his age was 4. So Abdullah ibn Umar, he has a she donkey. He had she donkey. And he went to Arafah to pray with the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, with his brother, and he forgot to tie the she donkey. And the she donkey, he joined the salat, and the she donkey crossed the donkey crossed al-atana, across the rows, and no one stopped this donkey. And we know from another hadith that three things can nullify your salat: the donkey, dog, and a mature woman if they cross. You know this affair? Three things, if two things and mature women, if they cross the prostration area between you and your sutra, you need to repeat your salat again. Donkey and dog and mature woman. This is one of the common affair in fiqh. And it's doubtful between scholars, but the scholars nowadays, they said the correct opinion, these three things can nullify the salat. So you need to prevent them from, you know, crossing the prostration area. So the sutra of imam, it's the sutra of Muslims behind him. The sutra of imam is the sutra of Muslims behind him. And we spoke about pronouncing the niyyah, like to say the niyyah audibly. And it's one of the common mistake in salat. And we spoke that, we said about, you know, the mistake of salat when we start the salat and we recite al-Fatiha and any surah and any dhikr without moving our lips. And this is one of the common mistake as well. We have also, you know, many mistakes. Like in ruku', some Muslims, they recite Quran in ruku'. Have you heard about this? Some of the Muslims, instead of saying Subhana Rabbi al-Azim wa bihamdih, they recite Quran, like Qul huwa Allahu ahad. Reciting Quran while in ruku', this is incorrect. طيب, how about if you say Subhana Rabbi al-A'la in ruku', and Subhana Rabbi al-Azim in sujood. It's a common mistake. A lot of, you know, Muslims, they miss. They say in ruku' Subhana Rabbi al-A'la instead of Subhana Rabbi al-Azim. It's correct and it's not a mistake. But the sunnah is to say Subhana Rabbi al-Azim. But if you say Subhana Rabbi Allah or Subhana Subhanallah in any form, it's acceptable. It's acceptable. If you miss saying Subhana Rabbi al-Azim, what should you do? This is a question. If you miss saying Subhana Rabbi al-Azim, or you forgot, or you have doubt, did I say Subhana Rabbi al-Azim in ruku', what should I do? It's duty. The duty, the forgetfulness, prostration will fulfill this. So all what you need to do is to pray sujood al-sahw. To pray sujood al-sahw. Before the salam. Before the salam, if you miss it or you have doubt, and if you add anything with Subhana Rabbi al-Azim, you pray sujood al-sahw after the salam. Inshallah, we will speak about sujood al-sahw. You know, sujood al-sahw, the Shafi'iyya madhab, they prayed before the salam. The Hanafi madhab, they prayed after the salam. The Malikiyya, they distinguish between increasing in your salat or like decreasing your salat, or if you have doubt. Or if you have doubt. And the other mistake I told you about the ruku', it's not to do the ruku' properly. Like, to put your back up a little bit, or you put your back down. And the correct thing is to put your back flat, if you can. If you can. If you have a disease, or you have like pain back, so فَاتَّقُوا اللَّهَ مَا اسْتَطَعْتُمْ. Obey Allah Azza wa Jal as much as you can. The other mistake in ruku', it's to say Allahu Akbar when you complete your ruku'. We know transition takbir, Allahu Akbar, between qiyam and ruku'. Then sami' Allahu liman hamidah rabbana wa lakal hamd. When do we need to recite this dhikr? Once we finish the movement, or while we are doing the movement? It's while we are doing the movement. This is what the scholar said, it's ta'mir al-arkan. It's another mistake. So I will give you an example about the mistake. Imagine if I want to go from qiyam to ruku'. Allahu Akbar. I said Allahu Akbar when I finished the ruku', when I finished reaching the position of ruku'. But the correct thing is to say Allahu Akbar. Allah, while I'm moving, and I finish when I reach ruku', like this. Allahu Akbar. And then Sami' Allahu liman hamida, Rabbana wa lakal hamd. So the dhikr, it's, and the transition takbir, it's when you move to the position of the salat, either it's ruku' or qiyam or sujood. This is one of the common mistakes. The other common mistake, and I'm pick up them randomly, it's not to say du'a al-istiftah, the introduction du'a, the du'a before al-fatiha. Some Muslims, they start Allahu Akbar, Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. So their salat is correct, but it's a mistake. And here we have two mistakes. Not reciting Dua al-Istiftah, the introduction Dua, and saying A'udhu Billahi Min Ash-Shaytan Ar-Rajim before that. A'udhu Billahi Min Ash-Shaytan Ar-Rajim, it's, we say that every ruk'ah, when we start the ruk'ah. Like تكبيرة الإحرام الله أكبر. I recite the introduction dua وجهت وجهي للذي فطر السماوات والأرض حنيفا مسلما وما أنا من المشركين إن نسكي ومحياي ومماتي لله رب العالمين وبذلك أمرت وأنا من المسلمين. This is one introduction to Allah. The other one, the most common one, سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك وتبارك اسمك وتعالى جدك ولا إله غيرك. This is short one. And we have another one, الله أكبر كبيرا والحمد لله كثيرا وسبحان الله بكرة وأصيلا. And we have another one, اللهم رب جبريل وميكائيل وإسرافيل فاطر السماوات والأرض عالم الغيب والشهادة أنت تحكم بين عبادك فيما كانوا فيه يختلفون اهدني لما اختلف فيه من الحق بإذنك أنت تهدي من تشاء إلى صراط مستقيم. And the fifth one, اللهم باعد بيني وبين خطاياي كما باعدت بين المشرق والمغرب. To the end. Why it's important to memorize them and try to pick up this one, then this one, this? Because you go away from the routine in your salat. And you have more khushu'. Because a lot of us, you know, Allahu Akbar, Subhanak Allahumma bihamdika tabaraka ismuka wa ta'ala jadduka wa la ilaha ghayruk. Then we recite Al-Fatiha, we look like we are doing kind of practice. And we, you know, be conscious at the end of the salat. And we say, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. And all the thoughts in the dunya, we have it inside the salat. And also, you know, some Muslims, they use it to find some stuff. If you lose items, they said, go to pray. Subhanallah. Why? Because you start contemplate. And you think, yes, I forget it in that place. So we are losing the khushu' in our salat. The first way to have khushu', it's to know to do the salat properly. The second one, it's to put everything back, you know, and also to pray like it's the last prayer for you. And try like to put your heart with Allah Azza wa Jal. So, أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم, it's after the introduction dua. In every ruk'ah. Like if you finish the first ruk'ah, you go to the second one, أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم, بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. You start like this. Another mistake in salat, it's how to put our hands where we are standing. So I told you some brothers, they do it like this, which is a mistake. Some brothers, they put it under the navel like this. And the correct way, it's to put it above the navel, between the navel and the chest. And we have in the sunnah two positions. One of them to hold the rest, and the other one to do like this, holding the rest with the three fingers. And to put it above the navel, not on the neck, and not above, not below the navel. And we have a kind of positions that the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam told us not to do it, which is takhsir, like this, and also isbal, like this. And I know some Muslims, they do it like this, especially north of Africa, Maliki madhab. Not all of them, the late scholars of Maliki, and also Ibadi. We spoke about Ibadi in Oman, and also Shia. The Rawafid, they put their hand, but it's khilaf al-sunnah. Why? Because we have clear, authentic narration. So no one can contradict this narration. So these kind of mistakes. Then I will speak about the mistakes when you go to the sujood, and when you are when you sit down and do a tahiyyat. So the first mistake, which is going to the sujood by your knees only, like this. Why? Because we have narration in Sunan Abi Dawood. نهى رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم أن يبرك الرجل كما يبرك البعير وليضع يديه قبل قبل ركبتي أو رفض محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم told us don't do like the camel and put your hands before your knees. So the correct way is Allahu Akbar. To put your hands, then your knees. You put your hands, then your knees, if you can. So if you have like disease, and some scholars said nowadays because we wear pants, and some Muslims, you know, they wear like short clothes, and then they expose their awrah. So exposing awrah or doing this makruh, disliked. They said no, do the disliked and don't expose the awrah and don't pray in these clothes anymore. This is what the scholar said. The other mistake in sujood, and after I finish the mistakes in sujood, I will tell you a story, inshallah. So it's not to make sujood in sab'ati a'zum, to put seven spoons on the ground. So what's the seven spoons? Seven bones. It's the hands, forehead, and the nose, knees, and toes. So the mistakes here in three bones always. The nose. This is like common mistake. Some brothers, they only put their forehead. And we have a narration of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, لا صلاة لمن لا يصيب أنفه ما يصيب الجبين. There is no salat for the one who his nose doesn't reach the ground as his forehead. So nose is with the head. And also the common mistake, it's not to make sujood in your toes. So they put their toes up, which is a common mistake. I had these slides with me about the mistakes, but inshallah, next time, I will show you how the majority of Muslims, the majority who does this mistake. So either they put their toes up, or they put their toes like this. And both of them are mistakes. They put their toes like this. And the correct way it's to put your toes like this. Otherwise, you are not performing good sujood, authentic sujood. You find this a lot with the Muslims. The other mistake, which is also common in sujood, it's when you sit between two sajda. And we know in sujood, you say Subhana Rabbi al-A'la wa bihamdi. But also you can say Sabbuhu Quddusu Rabbu al-Malaikati wa al-Ruh, or Sajada wajhi lilladhi khalaqahu wa shaqqa sam'ahu wa basara. I advise you and encourage you to memorize this. It's very easy to memorize them, and try to like use this time, that, you know, other time, and in this way you will have khushu' inshaAllah. And you can make dua while you are in sujood position. And this is the closest, you know, situation between you and your Lord, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So make dua, even if it's like, you know, for the dunya matter. Oh Allah, give me money. Oh Allah, make me buy this house in halal way. Oh Allah, you know, you can do and deal with Allah Azza wa Jal as you are a child. So Allah Azza wa Jal will not get bored of you. So make dua as much as you can. And when you sit between the two sajda, we have something we called it iqa', which is our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told us don't do it. The iqa', it's a position in salat. It's the scholars, they have many interpretations for iqa'. He told us our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam don't make iqa in salat. So the first situation of iqa, it's to do like this. This is iqa. This is one interpretations of iqa. And the other one, it's like this. I can't do it, but they put their, you know, put on the ground. This is the other way of iqa. And the iqa, it's only permitted between two sajda. Only. But if you want to make a tahiyyatu, the middle one and the last one, the iqa, it's makruh. It's disliked. So what's the sunnah way, how the sunnah way to sit down? We have two positions to sit down. Something we called it iftirash, and something we called it tawarruk. Iftirash like this. So you put your right foot up, and you sit on your left one. This is, we called it iftirash. And if there is salam after at-tahiyyatu, so you do tawarruk. Tawarruk, you bring the left one like this, and you sit on your bottom. I know some, it's hard for some Muslims to do it. But this is the sunnah. This is how our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to do it. So get into that habit. To do tawarruk, this is tawarruk. And this is iftirash. So iftirash, it's to put your right foot up and to put your bottom on your left one. And the tawarruk, it's to put your left bottom on the ground and move your feet underneath your right one. You can Google it. Alhamdulillah, nowadays we have sources of knowledge, but you need to find the authentic sources. And this is what Allah Azza wa Jal facilitated for us. Like, it's very busy life, so keep share of from your time to seek knowledge, because Allah Azza wa Jal will ask you about this knowledge. And I will tell you how it's important, this knowledge. The first hadith, our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, من سلك طريق علم سهل الله له طريق إلى الجنة. The one who seek knowledge, Allah Azza wa Jal will facilitate a pathway to the Jannah for him. And another hadith is the story that I want to tell you. This story, it's in Sahih al-Bukhari and Muslim. It's a narration. Abu Sa'id al-Khudri said that our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, كان في من كان قبلكم رجل قتل 99 نفسا. كان في من كان قبلكم رجل قتل 99 نفسا فأراد أن يتوب فقال دلوني على أعلم أهل الأرض فدلوه على راهب فقال ألي توبة؟ قال لا ليس لك توبة فقتله فأراد أن يتوب فقال دلوني على أعلم أهل الأرض فدلوه على عالم فقال ألي توبة؟ قال نعم ومن يحجب عنك باب التوبة؟ أخرج من أرضك إنها أرض فساد واخرج إلى قوم فلان فإن فيها قوما يعبدون الله فاعبد الله معهم فهو في الطريق قبضته الملائكة فأنزل الله عز وجل ملائكة الرحمة وملائكة العذاب فتنازعوا فيه فأنزل لهم ملكا فقضى بينهم فقال قيسوا المسافة إلى أرض الصالحين والمسافة إلى أرض السيئين أو الطالحين يعني الناس اللي يعملون السوء فأيهم كانت أقرب فلتقبضه ملائكتها فقال الله عز وجل لأرض الصالحين أن أقصري ولأرض الذين ظلموا أنفسهم أن مدي فوجدوه أقرب إلى أرض الصالحين بشبر فقبضته ملائكة الرحمة البخاري and Muslim reported that Abu Sa'id al-Khudri said that he heard our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, this is a story from the sons of Israel, the Bani Israel. Our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told them this story. The story of the man who killed 99 souls, 99 individuals. He killed 99 men or women. And then this man wanted to make tawbah. And he asked, you know, the people in front of him or the people of the village, I want to make tawbah. Who is the most knowledgeable one you know? And they told him, we have a monk, Rahib. Not a scholar, but a good man, a pious man, a monk. But not a scholar. And he went to that monk and he asked him, will Allah Azza wa Jal forgive me because I murdered 99 individuals? He said no. Then he killed him. So they became like 100. And then after a while, you know, he wanted to make tawbah. And he asked them again, دلوني على أعلم الأرض, guide me to the most knowledgeable one. Most knowledgeable one you know. فدلوه على عالم, they guided him to a scholar. And he asked him, أليا توبة, I murdered 100 individuals. Will Allah Azza wa Jal forgive me for this? He said, ومن يحجب عنك ما بدوبة, no one will make the tawbah away from you. The tawbah is between you and your Lord, Allah Azza wa Jal. Allah Azza wa Jal, the most merciful. But I advise you not to live with your people because they are bad people. They encourage you to do bad things. And here, you know, we have benefit. If you live in land and the people of this land guide you or encourage you to do bad things, immigrate to Allah Azza wa Jal for Allah's sake. And don't ask about the rizq. Don't ask about the rizq. Allah Azza wa Jal will give you the rizq. So this is what the companions did. So they immigrated, they left everything in Mecca, and they immigrated to Al-Madina. Why? Do they have their like citizenship or like, you know, they can get more benefits there, or like, you know, it's beautiful there? No. They immigrated for Allah Azza wa Jal's sake. Like Amr ibn al-Akwa. Amr ibn al-Akwa, he left everything. And he went to Al-Madina, was one of the companions. And this companion, he said, وَتَرَكْتُ أَهْلِي وَمَالِي مُهَاجِرٍ إِلَى اللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ, I left my family and my money for Allah's sake. And he left to Al-Madina, and he was like a kind of worker for Talha ibn Ubaidillah, one of other companion. So his job was like to guide his horse and to feed the horse and to clean the horse. And he left everything. So this is the mentality of the companions. If you can't apply your deen in a land, or the people of this land, or the rules of this land encourage you to do haram, or after a while you find yourself, you know, you accept the bad things, I advise you to do what the scholars advise this man who killed 100 individuals, humans. It's to leave your land to a land you can worship Allah Azza wa Jal on it. So he told him, go from your land because the people of your land is very bad and they encourage you to do bad things. And go to the land of such and such, because there are people there, they worship Allah Azza wa Jal, and you worship Allah Azza wa Jal with them. While he is in the road, Allah Azza wa Jal took his soul, like he passed away. And then angels of hell and angels of Jannah, they came down to take his soul. And they disputed one another. This is our Allah Azza wa Jal give us this as a story to tell us about his mercy. So they disputed one another. This man killed 100 humans. And this is what the angels of hell said. And the angel of Jannah, he said he made tawbah. And he was sincere in his tawbah. And then Allah Azza wa Jal sent another angel as a judge between them. And he said, measure the distance between the land of good people and the land of bad people. If he is close to the land of good people, the angels of Jannah shall take him. And if he's close to the land of the bad people, the angel of death shall take him. And with the mercy of Allah Azza wa Jal, Allah Azza wa Jal ordered the land of bad people to extend, and the land of good people to shrink. And the angel found him close to the land of the good people by one hand span, and they took him. Subhanallah, he killed 100 humans. Subhanallah. Imagine how the mercy of Allah Azza wa Jal.
Allah accepts his tawbah.
Yes. And Allah Azza wa Jal accepts the tawbah except in two situations. When the sun comes from the west, عندما تشرق الشمس من مغربها, this is the day of judgment, and when your soul becomes here. ما أن يغرغر. Yugharghar, that's mean, you know, you nearly passed away. Subhanallah. So, this is the time of questions. Time of question. Why, if we go to Lawahat Masjid, we find the Asr Salat, time, not like what you have here. This is correct and that is correct. But why we have 5:30 here and 6 there? Or like, you know, in your application, you have the Asr Salat even, you know, 1 hour before. Why?
Because of the distance.
Because of?
The distance between the two.
It's a double shadow.
Yes, this is double shadow. The difference is, this is, you need to understand this. We have 4 madahib. And actually we have more than 4 madahib, but this is the most famous madahib. Shafi'i, Maliki, Hanafi, and Hanbali. And all of them, they are our scholars. We grade them. And we love them and love the scholars. It's one of the sha'a'irullah. Ta'zim sha'a'irillah. Respecting the scholars, love them. It's glorifying the deen. And we have differences between scholars. So one of the differences between scholars and the time of the Salat. So, Hanafi Madhab, here in New Zealand, the Dominion Madhab, it's Hanafi Madhab. Why? Because the majority of Muslims here, from either Fiji, Pakistan, India, or Turkey, so our brothers. So the majority of Muslims there, they follow Hanafi Madhab. And the majority of people from Somalia, Egypt, Middle East, they follow either Maliki, Shafi'i, or Hanbali. In Somalia, they follow Shafi'i Madhab. It's Dominion Madhab. And they teach Matn al-Ghaya wa al-Taqrib and Minhaj al-Talibin and all these books. So why we have these? Because if you go to Pururua or you go like to, as I did in New Plymouth, I found like many differences in the time of the Salat. All of them correct, but to understand why we have these differences, you need to understand that in Hanafi Madhab, it's different from Shafi'i and Maliki and Hanbali in 2 times. Asr time and Maghrib time. Only two times. Asr time, we know that in Hanafi madhab, it should be two shadows. What's the meaning of two shadows? I will give you an example. Imagine if we have an object. An object on the ground and the sun here. So when the sun goes to the west side and the shadow of this object, imagine if it's like 1 meter object or like someone like me, 1.5 meter. So the shadow should be 3 meters. This is in Hanafi madhab. In Shafi'i madhab and Maliki madhab and Hanbali madhab, it should be one shadow. Single shadow. This is the differences between the two madahib. This is why you have in your application, if you apply Shafi'i Maliki Hanafi method, Hanbali method, or you apply Hanafi method in your application. You have Asr 1 hour before. Here in New Zealand, the sun, it's not like the sun in the equator. It's not exactly above the object. So this is another benefit. So imagine if you have an object, you have light on your cell phone. Imagine if this is an object. In equator, the sun like this. The shadow in zenith, zero. The shadow in zenith when the sun exactly above the object. In New Zealand, the sun like this. So we have shadow of the zenith. So what we do, if this is 25 centimeters, so the time of Asr, it's two shadow. 25 centimeters, 50 centimeters with 15, so it's 65, the shadow. Have you got it? Imagine if it's this one meter. If it's 1 meter, the shadow of the zenith, 15 centimeters. The time of Asr, it's double plus the shadow of the zenith. So it's 2 meter plus 15 centimeters. So this is how they calculated. And the time of, Jazakallahu khairan. In the time of Maghrib, the difference is, in Hanafi madhab, it's the end of Maghrib when the twilight, the white twilight disappears, the white one. In Shafi'i madhab and Maliki madhab and Hanbali madhab, the red one disappears. So what's the benefit we can get from this? The benefit is like what I will tell you right now. Imagine if I want to pray Maghrib. It's 8:14, it's correct time. So I pray Maghrib, but my brother, he said, I don't want to pray Maghrib right now, I will pray 9 o'clock. He prays Maghrib after the time of Maghrib. This is the point. Both of the madhahib, they pray exactly in the time, but the adhan is different. So the time of Maghrib will finish before the adhan of Isha. So you need to be careful. Especially in Shafi'i madhab, in all the books of Shafi'i, they said the time of Maghrib like this, adhan, then you pray with your imam. And you pray 2 ruk'ah, and the time of 5 ruk'ah after the imam, and it's done. It's done the time of Maghrib. So, you know, we are lazy. This is in our nature. So sometimes, you know, I don't want to pray Maghrib until 9 o'clock. No, if you get out, you find it's completely dark. Even if in Hanafi madhab, they consider it as done. So you need to be careful about the time of Maghrib. And also the other time, it's the time of Fajr. Some Muslims who don't want to go, who they don't have, you know, the mentality to to go to the Fajr prayer in the masjid. So they have their applications. So they pray exactly after the adhan of their application, of Fajr. You need to know Fajr has two adhan. One of them before the time. And the second one is after the time. This is from the time for Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. So the first adhan, it's before the time of Fajr. Why? What's the evidence of this? The evidence in Sahih Bukhari and Muslim. Our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam told us, إِذَا أَذَّنَ بِلَالٍ فَكُلُوا وَاشْرَبُوا حَتَّى يُؤَذِّنَ ابْنُ أُمِّ مَكْتُومٍ وَكَانَ لَا يُؤَذِّنُ حَتَّى يُقَالَ لَهُ أَصْبَحْتَ أَصْبَحْتَ. If Bilal established adhan, eat and drink in Ramadan until Ibn Maktoum establishes the other adhan. So what's the reason of the first one? It's to make you wake up. So in Mecca, they established this adhan 1 hour, 30 minutes, 1 hour, 15 minutes before the time of Fajr. And sometimes in the, like 3 o'clock, like 2 hours, especially in Ramadan. So imagine if I don't know this rule, I will pray Fajr straight away, especially if I want to go to sleep. So that means I pray not in the time of Fajr. So when can I pray? I can pray in the second adhan. Here it's 6:05, it's correct. You find the light in the horizon. You need to know the times of the salawat. It's something all of us have to know. Otherwise, you know, we miss the time of the salat. And if you don't pray in the time of the salat, your salat is incorrect, invalid.
Muslim pro,
these applications, they use calculation method. What's the fatwa of the calculation method? And like our brothers in North America and in Europe, they use like 18, the angle 18, the angle between sun and horizon, they use it like 18. Here in New Zealand, Fayans, the brothers, our brothers in Fayans, they use, I think, 15 or 16. So what's the fatwa, what the scholar said about the calculation method? The calculation method, we can't use it to determine the time of Ramadan. This is consensus. To determine the first day of Ramadan and the end of day of Ramadan, no. But for the salawat, we can use it, but we need to confirm it's correct. Like, we don't have research that this is correct in New Zealand. Imagine, like. Yeah, I will take this. I hope this is clear. For Ramadan, the Council of Fatwa said no. Why? Because we have narration. Our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, نَحْنُ أُمَّةٌ أُمِّيَّةٌ لَا نَقْرَأْ وَلَا نَكْتُبْ وَالشَّهْرُ كَذَا هَكَذَا وَهَكَذَا. That's, we are illiterate nation. We don't write, we don't calculate. And the month will be like this and like this. Because they had calculation method. There is explanation for this narration, why we are illiterate nation. But the scholars, the consensus of the scholars said, we can't use the calculation method to determine the beginning of Ramadan and the end of Ramadan, but we can use it in the salat, in one condition. If we examine this, we can apply it here, either like 18 degrees, 15 degrees, because if you go to Muslim Pro, you find like, I think 15 methods, and the difference is it's the angle, 18, 15. What I want to tell you, first of all, you need to learn the time of the salawat. This is the first one. The second one, all the salawat and all the masajid in New Zealand correct. And you know, we have committee. Like in Lawahat, we have committee to see the moon, to observe the time, and we pick up like days to see if the calculation method applies to the time, especially if it's sunny. If it's not sunny, you know, we can't do anything. So we estimate. So all the times in New Zealand correct. If you go to the other masajid and you find another time, no, you have to know that they are following another opinion and their opinion is valid. And you pray with them and you don't like contradict them to say why you, they are praying like this, why they are, no. This is forbidden in Islam. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله العظيم لكم. I know the materials of fiqh, it's a little bit hard. So not like, you know, the others. So please forgive me if I make it long. Yes. I said I don't want to take questions, but...
my concern is about yeah. the mazahib.
Yes.
So the mazahib come with their own opinion.
Yes.
But the Rasul, if we trace it back to time of Rasul, is a prophet, because most of the mazahib, when they say, what we say is if it contradicts what Rasul practiced, you should do our rod, I mean, you should turn our own down and follow Rasul. So because there are some discrepancies, you know, different people with a different opinion. So we've taken the mazahib more than what Rasul has done. So those are the things that cause issues.
I will answer your question. The opinion that the madahib contradicts what our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is wrong. Why? It couldn't, you know, be that, you know, either Abu Hanifa or Imam Shafi'i or Imam Malik or Imam Ahmad, you know, contradict the sunnah of our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and they didn't have this mentality at all. They may make ijtihad. I will give you an example. And this is common example. Like in Hanafi madhab, a woman can start the marriage of the contract marriage without the permission of her sponsor, of her wali. And the contract will be correct. They said if the sponsor exists, they said it's sunnah, it's extremely sunnah to have his agreement. But in Hanafi madhab, they said it's acceptable if the sponsor not exist. In Shafi'i madhab and Maliki madhab and Hanbali madhab, they said the marriage contract is invalid. But why Abu Hanifa said like this? And why Imam Shafi'i and Imam Malik and Imam Ahmad said like this? The three of this imam, they narrated the narration of Aisha. Any woman get married without the permission of her wali, her marriage is invalid, her marriage is invalid, her marriage is invalid. This is in Sahih Bukhari. But Imam Abu Hanifa, rahimahullah, he didn't get the narration. Why? Because he was in Iraq. And in Iraq that day, there were a lot of layers. So he put like restricted rules to apply to take the narration. So what he did, he didn't have narration. And he had this affair. What he did analogy. A woman can sell a house she owns without the permission of her father. Is that right? This is consensus. And then he said the marriage of contract and the marriage of the contract marriage and the selling, the trading contract. So he made analogy. This is what Imam Abu Hanifa rahimahullah. So the idea that a lot of people said the madahib, it's like contradicts our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. No, this is extremely wrong. Especially if you read the madahib. Al-Shafi'i, he said, if I say something and you know that narration I don't know is correct, leave my opinion and take the opinion of our Prophet, the narration of our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Abu Hanifa said, we are men. We say something and we take it back next day. And Imam Malik said, don't write all my students, don't write all what I said, because we are men. And everyone we can take from him and throw it away except the man in that grave. And he pointed to our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So the opinion that the madahib contradicts, no. But you may find like an opinion in this madhab contradict the opinion in that madhab. In this case, what should we do? وَإِذَا تَنَازَعْتُمْ فِي شَيْءٍ فَرُدُّوهُ إِلَى اللَّهِ وَالرَّسُولِ إِن كُنتُمْ تُؤْمِنُونَ بِاللَّهِ وَالْيَوْمِ الْآخِرِ ذَلِكَ خَيْرٌ وَأَحْسَنُ تَأْوِيلًا. If you refute one another in any affair in dunya, go to Allah and His Messenger, the Book of Quran and the Sunnah, to make them judge between you if you believe in Allah and Hereafter. So this is completely wrong. The madhahib don't contradict or Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, but we have an opinions, you know, and ijtihadat in each madhab. And even the scholars of the madhab, they take it away. Like, you know, in this affair, like if the marriage contract is valid in Hanafi madhab, Imam Abu Yusuf, because we know in Hanafi madhab we have Imam Abu Hanifa and four scholars, Abu Yusuf al-Qadi and Muhammad ibn al-Hassan al-Shaybani and Zifr ibn al-Hudayl and Zifr ibn al-Hudayl. The last one is Abu Ziyad al-Lu'lu'i. So these four scholars, two of them, Abu Yusuf and Muhammad ibn al-Hassan, they said, no, the marriage contract will be invalid. So even in Hanafi madhab, they said no. And what should we do? It's to say, may Allah shower His mercy upon all of them. Allahumma ameen. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله العظيم لي ولكم.